All right. Hello, everyone. I have bad news and good news. So the bad news is I'll be speaking to you for the next about 2 hours. The good news is the door is open. You can leave anytime you want. So don't worry. So Frank did not make it. Therefore, I will take over his talk. And because my talk will be after his, hence the 2 hours. I will not be talking about Nextcloud here. That's just the first slide. I'm happy to talk about that separately, obviously, but I think pretty much all of you already know it. So that's preaching to the choir in any case. I'll be talking about the GPL and how the GPL, Frank and me both think. So I'll say we, sometimes I, but just think we if I say I. Well, we think the GPL is great for business. Now, again, I'm not Frank, but I'll keep this slide in just so you get a reference of who made them. I'm the head of marketing at Nextcloud. I come from before from SUSE, and before that, business consulting, but I'm recovering. Thank you for asking. And, well, as marketing guy, I write a lot of blogs and, you know, tweet and things like that. And, of course, also Frank and me discussed a lot about this company and what business models to use and other stuff. And these things we will talk about in here as well. And the GPL is a big part of that. So I want to talk about free software here, and I will mix up the term free software with open source, because even though I know very well there is a difference there, however subtle it might or might not be, for the purpose of this talk, they are essentially equivalent. So I will quickly talk about licenses. I'm going to try to keep this as brief as possible, mostly because all of you probably already know pretty much everything I would be able to say about this and then some, so that'd be a waste of everybody's time. Then I will go over a bunch of open source business models on which I'll spend a little bit more time, if only because Wikipedia has quite an interesting list of them and I didn't want to skip any of them. And last but not least, of course, I will go through a bunch of reasons why we believe the GPL is great for businesses, including some examples of that. All right. So starting with free software, I mean, still can't really go and skip about the part about Richard Stallman in the 80s, who started this as a social idealistic idea. And he came up with these four freedoms that define, the free software movement very well. So first would be the freedom to run the program as you wish, the freedom to study how it works, the freedom to make changes, the freedom to redistribute it, as well as the freedom to redistribute it with those changes. Now, the open source definition came later, but it's largely, I would say, in the same spirit. It's a similar idea. And, you know, it also talks about the free distribution. It talks about the source code and the importance of that. Why did that just happen? Okay. Right. It even explicitly mentions the no discrimination against persons or groups, just like, of course, the GPL says you can run the code however you want, wherever you want. That is one of the four freedoms. And, you know, again, geez, okay, might have a cable issue here. I hope not, but yeah. Can we go back to what was supposed to be there? All right, let me quickly restart the presentation. All right. Anyway, so I think the big question with this is, in reality, how to live with these rules and with these licenses. And the key thing always to understand when you're talking about these licenses is they are really only relevant when you distribute the code. So when you give your code to somebody else, the GPL and the other open source licenses, they then give these freedoms to the person who is receiving the code from you. And I think that's a key here to understand. Only then the license is really relevant. Now, there's a bunch of different license types that go from most permissive to, well, least permissive. I'll quickly go over them. Like you have the public domain, which basically says do whatever the hell you want with my code. You even give up ownership, essentially. It used to be a bit common, but, you know, local laws sometimes make this a difficult one. You can't even give up ownership technically in Germany, for example. So these days, you have the permissive license, the MIT and the BSD style licenses, and they essentially say, do whatever you want, but don't sue me, don't bother me with it. And these are today still very common licenses used a lot in academia, but also, well, companies working together, Apache, etc. Then you have, well, what came to be known as the copyleft licenses. And, you know, you can have very long discussions about whether they are more or less free as the previous one. Because on one hand, of course, the GPL and similar licenses, they add a restriction. But that restriction essentially guarantees the freedom of the recipient of the code. Yeah, so the restriction that is added by them is that it says when you distribute the code under these rules, you have to enforce that these same rules apply to the whole again, you know, for the person who receives them. So the code is free today and it will remain under the same rules in the future, even if modifications and changes are made. Now, this is, in a way, viral. The code spreads, or at least the license spreads. This has resulted in some nasty comparisons being made in the past by certain big American companies that I will skip on, but most of you probably know about. But this is the principle behind it. It spreads and it's protective, and hence the term protective here. It protects the freedom in a way by taking you away the freedom of the author to take away the freedom of other people, which is kind of an interesting just juxtaposition. Anyhow, the next step is, of course, well, the proprietary licenses. These are the standard licenses that companies like Microsoft and, you know, other big companies that are selling software are using, and the license usually boils down to give me money, you can use it. Of course, you still can't sue me, and you still can't expect that it does anything that I promised you it would do, et cetera, et cetera. The license terms are usually awful, but nobody reads them anyway, so, you know, that's only a problem when you get in a lawsuit. And, well, totally at the end of the spectrum, you have the trade secrets, where basically it's a matter of don't look at it, don't talk about it, don't think about it. It doesn't exist except that it's there. So now these licenses that we use, the protective, free, and open source licenses, they work for us as a community. We use them. We use them to collaborate, work together, and they're okay. But we want more than that. And this guy that many of you probably also know, he used to joke in the 90s that his goal was world domination. Now, he said it was a joke. He also says he has stopped saying it because he kind of succeeded at that, which is good. But I think it does point out this thing about open source that a lot of us are ambitious. We want to do something here more than just play around together and have fun. We want to change the world, have an impact on the world. Now, you know, if you want to make an impact, it helps if you can spend more time on it than your free evenings or your time as a student, right? It helps a lot if you can actually spend full time on making an impact. And for that, it would be very helpful to drive faster and be paid to do what you want to do in open source. Now, I'm going to talk for a minute to try and illustrate this point, called a bit of an anecdote, I guess, or a piece of history that I happened to share with Frank. We both got involved in the KDE community. Now, he in the late 90s, I was a couple of years later than that, mid-2000s. And, you know, the KDE community is a completely community-driven project. It develops Linux desktop software, and there are, on a formal level, pretty much no companies involved, and that has, over the years, there has been a little bit of involvement, but pretty much companies just give money to KDE, which is then used to fund a little bit of travel to events, and otherwise everything is done in the free time of people. Now, this works. I mean, I use it myself. I think it results in impressive software. And, you know, everybody can contribute and commit. It's completely free and open source. But one of the biggest issues that the KDE community had is that the turnover is enormous. Every year, I think 20-30% of people leaves. So you have to recruit at an impressive scale. And I mean, the KDE community is really good at this. If you want to get onboarded somewhere, just try KDE or GNOME, which has a very similar situation that they are in. Yeah, they're amazing at teaching people and getting people involved and motivating them and keeping them involved for a few years. But a typical thing that happens is somebody comes in as a student. You know, they're maybe studying computer science, they're interested in tech, and they have enough free time that they are actually able to do something else besides studying, which, by the way, restricts the audience severely, which is why open source is so big in Central Europe and not so much in much of the rest of the world. And, you know, they start to contribute, and first small, and then it gets bigger and bigger, and by the time they're finishing their studies, they're probably pretty serious contributors, maybe even maintaining code, and then they get a job. And then it's over. Because, you know, when you work 40 hours a week and you're writing code and, you know, you have your boss telling you what to do, your motivation to write even more code in your free time, it varies between people, but usually it decreases significantly if it doesn't just flat out disappear. But it's really sad. Like, a lot of knowledge and a lot of, you know, experience just disappears. And this happens every 3-4 years on average for a person. Yeah, I don't have statistics on this, but if Lydia were here, I bet she might be able to tell us how many years the average contributor gets involved. But I wouldn't be surprised if it's like 2 years, maybe 3. You know, I mean, I know there are people who have been involved for decades and decades, but they are really a minority. Yeah, I probably know a third of them. Probably more, actually. So a lot of people, I know Frank did at the time, had this dream of hiring people and let them work full-time, all the time, on KDE to make it really better, to be able to do this last mile that you often need to do. Instead of starting a new music player, let's finish one for once. So he had a company that he was using, and occasionally he tried to do projects around KDE and sponsor people to work on KDE, and he ran these websites, the open collaboration services. Many of you might know them as KDEloop.org and GnomeLoop.org and KDEapps.org, GnomeApps.org and others. And that allowed him to sponsor some stuff, like, for example, what very creatively was named Get Hot New Stuff, which had a nice interface in KDE to get wallpapers and themes and scripts and other stuff, which would then be taken directly from these websites. But it never became really big, of course. So the question you got to ask yourself then is, okay, if you want to get to pay people to work on something, yeah, this method of like, yeah, you know, we sponsor somebody, that doesn't work. Right? You need a business model, you need a company. And the question then is, what do people pay for? Because, you know, we live in a capitalist society, and unless you have something to give, there's nobody who's going to give you money for it. Yeah, and our licenses, they kind of make this hard, because, you know, the whole point is sharing. Yeah. So what are the open source business models? So I already mentioned Wikipedia, which is also free, of course, by the way. They have a nice list of business models, and I'm going to go over that. Now, the first couple might not be that relevant, but it gets better, I promise. So the first business model is used by KDE and GNOME, which is also why I would empathically not call it a business model, because it doesn't pay anybody's salary. But yes, you can sell branded merchandise. I don't think this scales at all. I think that's pretty obvious, so I'm not going to spend more time on this. Now, this one is actually working in some companies. So, for example, WordPress.com uses this. They make the WordPress software, which makes sure that everybody knows WordPress, makes themes for it, and you know, has experience with it and knowledge with it, which makes them completely dominate the CMS space. And they make their money by offering people hosted WordPress. It's a kind of decent model, and there's a bunch of companies that is doing similar things, and, you know, I think this can work fairly well. It's not always easy, and it's getting harder and harder with the cloud. I will get to that later. Now, this model baffled me a little bit, and Frank as well. Partnership with funding organizations. We're not entirely clear if this means government funding or partnering with, like, I don't know, the Red Cross. But either way, there is actually some interest in government funding, and of course there is a project like Public Money, Public Code, where the FSFV is trying to convince the world that if the public is paying for code, they should actually be able to get access to it and, you know, use it however they want, rather than having companies walk away with the profits. I think that's a very noble movement and I completely support it. I think it could actually drive a lot of open source development, but of course not everything. And I think that's also the issue with pretty much every one of these models. They all have a niche, but they can't solve every problem. Now, one thing that's used is selling certificates and trademark use. So, for example, you could sell, you know, essentially certification service for, I don't know, Apache. And you could sell the right to put an Apache logo on your website. Could that make money? Yeah, sure. Would it be a lot? I don't think so. Could it pay for all of Apache's work? No way in hell. So, donations, yeah. So this kind of works for Wikimedia. KDE and GNOME do this. It doesn't pay any developer salaries, but it does certainly help with travel support. But again, this does not allow you to build a company and build a product like, for example, we did at Nextcloud. We have people on the forums once or twice asking, hey, can we donate money? I've made a back of the envelope calculation once on our forum somewhere. I said, okay, if everyone on the forums here donates $10, and we have a lot of people on our forums, we can pay 2 developers. We are currently paying 25. How much do you think this helps? Really, it's nice, but it doesn't run a company. Yeah. Again, there are a few exceptions. I'm still surprised with Wikimedia. But then they have about, I don't know, an audience of 7 billion. So I guess that can work. Then there's bounty-driven development. So we facilitate this in our community. It's a model where essentially, you know, there's somebody who wants a certain button somewhere. You know, they get together with a couple of other people who want the same button there. Everybody throws in $10 until it gets to a point that somebody says, you know, there's enough money here that I can spend some time to build the button. And then you get the button and everybody's happy. This kind of works, but it is, first of all, very far from funding everything. And of course, it doesn't fund refactoring or releasing or any of the infrastructure, which is a problem with some of the other models as well. Essentially, yeah, it gets you a coffee and a cake, and it's nice. But honestly, I don't think it is a real model that can really scale well. Advertising. Now you think, yeah, I can put ads in my app, but people can take it out, and that's certainly true. And yet, there is one company or organization that makes massive amounts of money with this model. That's Mozilla. Because, of course, they ship Firefox, and they get, I think, hundreds of millions even for the default search there. Of course, in a way, you could argue this is also the business model behind Android, because, you know, Google is all ads. But still, I don't think that this is something that every open source project could use, far from it. Kind of an interesting model is the idea to use delayed open source. So essentially what you as a customer would pay for is to get the product now because it's still proprietary, but in 6 months the code will become open source. Or maybe 12 months or a year or, you know, something like that. I don't think it's a completely stupid model. I actually think there is some potential benefit to it, especially if you want to start up a company. You know, if you look at the history of my company, building the code base to a point that you can actually run a profitable company around it in terms of services. I mean, yes, we are at that point now, but would we have been able to get there starting from nothing? I think that's really hard. And of course, you could kind of make a deal with the community, like, hey, we have a CLA and other stuff in place for 5 years, and at the end of the 5 years, everything becomes completely open. And until then, we have kind of maybe an advantage. I don't know, it's maybe there are ways you can use this, but I don't think it's a very popular model, and it has a bunch of downsides as well. This, I think, is just plain proprietary, but you know, the point is that at the end of the life cycle of software, it becomes open source. Yeah, so when nobody cares anymore, you open source it. I don't think it solves anything, but hey, it exists. Now, here is a model that is actually really popular and used a lot, and this is professional services, consulting. Yeah, you have a product consulting firm around it, and there are literally dozens who do this model, and it kind of works. It has a whole bunch of downsides, though. I mean, you're not paid for innovation. You're paid for adding that specific button the customer wants. But the releases, the product management itself, any vision and innovation, any infrastructure, you still have to pay for yourself as a consulting company. And sure, you make per hour nice money, I hope, but it still doesn't scale. I don't think there's any company that really manages to be a consulting company around the product and has more than 50 employees or so. This is just not a very scalable model. It always keeps you small. But it does work, and there are a lot of companies who do this. Well, then there's the open core model. I mean, I think most of you know that we have a little bit of experience with this. I'm not a huge fan, mostly because it essentially boils down to using open source as a marketing tool. Because in the end, what the customer gets is, of course, not open source at all. It's just a proprietary product with all the downsides that come with that. And I think that that explains why it's not a very popular model in open source. It's used a fair bit, but I don't think it's a very good model. It has issues with long-term survival, let me put it that way. Then you have dual licensing, which I think is quite interesting. This also can work for libraries. The Qt project uses this. Essentially, you pay to not have to comply with the open source license. In a way, it might sound horrible, but of course, if you're a company and you've built a router and you've in that router you're using a product that has GPL and you're going to distribute this and you don't want to have to give away all your really cool additions that are probably, by the way, really crappy, but you know, you think it's cool, and you don't want to have to give that away, then you could, of course, pay the original company behind that product to not have to share the source code of the changes you made. And this is a model that works. It's not absolutely amazing, and it's, of course, controversial, because it also means that anybody who wants to contribute to the project has to give the code, essentially, to the company behind it. Otherwise, it doesn't work, right? If they can't give this license to someone, they can't do that if they don't own it. So it requires complete ownership, and I don't think that's good. Now, what I think is the most successful model, if only because a rather big IT company just paid $34 billion for a company that uses this model as proof. This model is essentially you're selling a support subscription, and the way I like to put it is what you're selling is insurance. If you're a bank, you run a big an important product in production, and it's important for your for your bottom line. You want to be sure that you can call somebody who can fix it. And who is the best person to call? Well, the person who wrote the code, or the company who wrote the code. And this model scales, because it's like an insurance. You know, you don't spend an hour extra on every hour that you sell. You can sell a lot more support hours than you actually need to use in general. So, to illustrate this a little bit, I'm just going to share with you how we kind of present the Nextcloud subscription to our customers. We tell them there are four benefits to it, but this is, of course, just an example. It's the exact same with Red Hat and with SUSE. They use this same model, I would rather say it the other way around, that we copy theirs. So, you sell expertise. If you call Nextcloud support team, you don't get a support engineer who says, hey, have you tried turning it on and off again? You get one of our engineers, and they know what they're talking about pretty much by definition. If you have a problem with LDAP, you get the person who wrote the LDAP integration in Nextcloud, who can help you probably better than pretty much anyone. So this really makes a difference. And then, of course, you have the SLAs and the long-term support and all these other things that is hard to deliver if you're not, Nextcloud GmbH. Now, influence on roadmap. In theory, of course, I mean, we focus at least part of our efforts on where the customers want us to go. And given that we employ, depending on what part of Nextcloud you look at, about 60, 70, 80% of the engineering resources, we have a big influence on the direction the project takes. Stability, I mean, again, we have documentation knowledge inside to make sure you get the best support, and so does, for example, a company like Red Hat. I mean, RHEL is noticeably more stable than Fedora, I think, in many ways, and especially if you're running it in a bank at huge speeds and at huge scale, then, Red Hat can help you really well to get it up and running reliably. And of course, compliance, if you don't have anybody to complain to other than a few open source developers, yeah, it's better to have a company that you can point to when there's an issue with the GDPR or such. Anyway, so as summary, I'm saying this is the best working business model. And to hammer that point home, this is Red Hat, who managed to really do a good job with this business model, I think. But nothing's ever perfect, and this business model isn't either. There is a rather big problem on the horizon. Call it a new enemy in town, and it's called the cloud. Because the cloud kind of makes it really hard on this. So what's cloud computing? Well, you know, it's a move to buy everything as a service. And if you get SQL as a service from, say, Amazon, they might be running MySQL under there, but you're not in need of a support subscription from MySQL because, I mean, you know, you're getting your service from Amazon and it'll work reliably. And Amazon isn't going to be in need of support subscription from MySQL because, you know, they can just throw a can of engineers at it. They don't need them. And there's, of course, the same that's true with pretty much any one of these really big cloud companies. So this throws a wrench into the whole support subscription model and can make it quite of a pain to run this. Now, how have the responses been in the open source business community? Not great, I think. So Redis came up with the idea of the commons clause, which tells, well, you know, you can no longer use our software if you're one of these big cloud providers unless you pay us money. Yeah, kind of solves the problem by, I don't know, drowning the baby or something. It's not really working. I mean, yes, the marketing about this kind of move is they say we're trying to save open source, but I would argue that just killed it, which is pretty much what Simon Phipps also said at the time. Yeah, MongoDB, it's the same thing. They basically say, look, if you run this in your for-profit company, we want you not just to open the code of MongoDB itself if you make any changes, but also of everything else in your infrastructure. So also your billing backend and everything else. And that's, of course, unacceptable for most of the cloud hosting companies. It's just proprietary licensing. Yeah, it's no longer open source. Again, same story with CockroachDB. They just said it's not allowed. Simple, effective, and no longer open source. Now, again, there's some marketing where there are people arguing that this is great and, you know, this is what open source needs to do and, you know, we need to go this direction. Open source is being abused. Well, I kind of disagree. I mean, the open source license allows exactly this software as a service model. I agree that it's not nice for business, but it's not abused. This is what the license was supposed to do and it does what it's designed to do. Yeah, you're saving it by killing it, as far as I'm concerned. And, well, I don't think that's needed. I think it's harmful. I think there's a lot of benefits to the GPL as a business license, even though, yes, there are some threats perhaps to it. And you know, I know fairly well how hard it is to run a completely open source company, but it's certainly still possible. So I'm going to try and make that case now with a bunch of reasons why we think the GPL and other copyleft licenses are great for business. I think one of the key points here is that it's an incredibly good tool to build a community. And it's the GPL makes everybody equal. It's a great equalizer. There's not one company that can do something special like with OpenCore or one of the other licenses. Everybody has the same rights and the same freedoms, and that keeps everybody honest. And this is, of course, where forks come in. Yeah, if anybody thinks that we're taking Nextcloud in the wrong direction, please go ahead and fork it. We've seen how that can work. And this enforces the best results. It keeps everybody honest. I think that's a good thing. Now, another thing is the code islands. And I was just having a discussion here with a couple of other people about this subject. Yeah, if you make your software GPL or even MIT, yeah, it doesn't even have to be copyleft for this, your software can be part of another piece of software. Yeah, Nextcloud would not be possible without building on hundreds of pieces of code that come from all kinds of other projects and communities. Now, if each of them had a different commons clause and no commercial this and other that license, we couldn't use it. And we wouldn't have been able to build something like Nextcloud. And the whole thing that we're all doing, building products by using pieces from other projects. It's just all comes falling down. This does not work. And, you know, it's also about the people, right? People are really important, and perhaps in a way people are more important than the code and the ownership and all that. And people like writing open source code more than writing the fifth CMS backend at a big bank, because they just don't want to use whatever open source thing is lying around. It's just more fun. And I've seen this in real life multiple times. And the other thing, also keep in mind, it's an ecosystem play these days. If you want to compare Nextcloud to its competitors, one of the important things that we have over a competition is there are more than 200 apps for Nextcloud. So if you want to do something with Nextcloud, there's a bigger chance you can do it with Nextcloud than with a competing solution, because they don't have all these extensions done by community members. Why do community members do that? Well, because we have this level playing field. Yeah, they're not working for us. They're doing this as much for themselves as for anyone else, because we're all under the same rules of the AGPL. Another thing that the GPL does is it enforces, well, I think, good community governance. If you look at Kubernetes and OpenStack and these other communities that use an MIT or another non-copyleft license, they have all these rules. They have loads of governance. They have committees. They have, you know, foundations and all kinds of pieces of infrastructure to essentially create and enforce governance. And what does the Linux kernel have? Pretty much nothing. The GPL does the same thing. You're done. It just kind of enforces good behavior. So it makes it a lot easier. The GPL makes a contribution happen there. And also a thing to keep in mind, customers like it. You know, they like open source because they don't have the vendor lock-in and other issues with it. And, you know, if the service is bad, you can find another company to help you service it or hire engineers yourself. Yeah, this backing is there and makes a difference. So I already made the point about people. In the end, the value is in the people, unless, of course, you want to do an IPO or another big exit, at which point, well, it's hard to calculate the value of people, I suppose, especially because they can leave if they don't like the IPO or the exit. But this is, of course, a fact. Yeah, so another really interesting thing is this strategy that Red Hat essentially did with CentOS. Now, I was, well, at a competitor at the time when Red Hat decided to buy CentOS, and I thought it was brilliant. CentOS is like a free version of Red Hat Enterprise Linux, which is kind of like, if you're a salesperson, that's terrible. I mean, you're trying to convince a customer that, you know, Red Hat Enterprise Linux is much better than Fedora, especially because they're a business and this is an ideal solution. They should definitely, you know, pay money for this. And then a bunch of people comes around and essentially makes a free copy of it. So suddenly you're competing with, well, a free copy of your own product. And, you know, you're back to having to convince them that the support calls are worth it. And you don't have a product anymore. And it's a lot easier, I can tell you, to sell a product, because that's still what most companies are used to buying. Product is, well, that's always easy. Services, much harder. But because CentOS was everywhere, because it was free, it became a de facto standard. Yeah, if you want to test some kind of application for your bank, well, you spin up a CentOS. You don't need to look for licenses, you don't need to check anything, and you know it's a good platform. And the moment you do need to bring it into production, you know who to call and who to give money to make sure it's supported. Yeah, that's just a smart strategy, and it works for them. It's the same for us at Nextcloud. This just works. And, well, I just gave that example, of course, already. Yeah, if you have another department who wants to use the products, I mean, yes, you could go to the vendor, ask for extra licenses, but first let them try it out. Just give them a copy, let them run CentOS, let them just install Nextcloud, give it a try. And then, yeah, at some point they can get a support contract. So this gives a lot of freedom to that customer. Yeah. Another thing, and I find it fascinating that sometimes the opposite argument is being made, all these licenses, the GPL and the AGPL and the MIT, they are very widely used. They're therefore also widely understood and widely discussed and debated. So as a company, it's a much riskier proposition to get a license from a random small company that puts in God knows what in that proprietary license, as opposed to just getting such a commonly understood license like the GPL. It's well, you can skip a lot of review, or rather you just have to do the review once, and then everybody that's selling you GPL software services, you can just say, okay, we've already checked it. Now, I think this is another obvious one. I mean, if you have a license like the Commons license that says only MongoDB can support MongoDB in a commercial instance, and MongoDB goes bankrupt, and you want to run a commercial instance, what are you going to do then? I mean, that's kind of an extortion model, of course. I mean, MongoDB will not go bankrupt as long as they can extort customers that way, which is also not a fun position to be in as customers. This is not the case with the GPL, yeah? Again, it's a level playing field. Well, I think not all licenses, of course, have patent protection, so I like that that's in there as well. Now, I've given you this whole bunch of arguments, and I'm going to give you three real-life examples that we ourselves encountered in, well, previous business we worked at. And the first would be the contributor license agreement. Yeah, this is really not liked by a lot of contributors. We had people who said, look, I'm not a lawyer. I don't want to read and then sign a piece of paper, not understanding what's in there and what it's going to do. And I don't want to hand out my code. And besides, you know, if I hand out my code by signing a piece of paper and giving it to you as a company so you can sell it, I should get paid. I want to do this as a volunteer. But if you don't want to let me do it as a volunteer, then I want to get paid. And this is, of course, a good argument. And yeah, we had people who just went unhappy and left the project. And, well, we fixed that, obviously, by just not having a CLA anymore. I mean, all our engineers in the company, they contribute everything under their own copyright. Yeah, so under their own name. I mean, not company name, it's just a private email address, and it's on a private name. Because, I mean, we have no interest in owning the code. They own it, and that's fine. Another thing was that, yeah, a lot of the employees in the company, they were not happy if they had to write proprietary extensions to the LDAP or had to write a proprietary backend for this or that. This, sure, that might not be the case if you get your employees from a big bank who are used to writing proprietary code, but of course, if you want to hire open source engineers from your community who are contributing so that you don't need to spend a lot of money on recruiting and testing people, which saves you a lot of money, seriously, then, yeah, you're going to notice it's pretty hard to make those people write proprietary software, because guess what? They got involved because they didn't have to in your project. So, yeah, this is a pain in the ass to have these discussions again and again and again. It gets pretty tiring. And also the customers are not happy if you have to tell them that actually, no, you cannot keep running the software after the contract ends, because actually, no, you did not deploy an open source product. It was proprietary. You just thought it was open source because our marketing convinced you. That was not really fair to these customers, and they were unhappy about this sometimes. Okay, so I'm making the argument here that the GPL is absolutely awesome. But then why are companies changing their license, right? There is clearly, apparently, a problem. Now let's go back to this article from TechCrunch that says that it's really awesome to create these licenses. And if you scroll down in the article, I think you find a explanation why this is bad. So the person who wrote this is a venture capitalist. And I think the conclusion we can take to some degree here is that it's not really open source that's being threatened. It was his business model and the business model of a bunch of other venture capital people who pour billions into companies like MongoDB and suddenly discover that, yeah, a big company can, you know, do with the code what they want, because that's what the license allows. And of course, I don't like that. But then again, they shouldn't have invested in an open source company, in my opinion. Look, I think the model is fine. Yes, it's not easy, and you have to do a good job, work hard at it, and I'm happy to discuss that with any of you if you have, well, questions, thoughts, or issues. And it might not work in every case, but then there's a bunch of other business models you can try. But I don't think we should abandon the four freedoms and basically kill the ideals that we built this community on just because a bunch of venture capitalists doesn't like it, all right? So, thank you. Questions? I was already afraid everybody would just agree and it would be over.
I have a question. You made this argument that the GPL compared to other open source licenses, especially permissive licenses, makes for better communities. And I'm pretty sure that a lot of open source communities which are not using copyleft licenses but permissive licenses would disagree with that. But I find the idea fascinating. So could you elaborate on that? What are the reasons why the license actually should make a difference there?
So first of all, I don't have extremely strong feelings on this because it's a complicated subject. So, but fair enough, of course, to ask a question about that. So I do think that the GPL kind of enforces a more level playing field. And it keeps, it's a social contract for a longer term. But this comes back to, of course, the whole discussion between the more permissive and the less permissive and which one is more free discussion that I mentioned in the beginning. But I do think that, let me put it this way, if you're contributing as a student to KDE or as a billion-dollar company or a million-dollar company like SUSE, for example, you're in a way more equal in what you can do with the product. I would argue then when it would be an MIT licensed product. Because in that case, well, SUSE would have a lot more abilities to perhaps build proprietary add-ons that you as a student wouldn't be able to put together than in a, well, in a GPL world that's much more limited and you would still be able to get the code. So I think it just enforces this level playing field more. And I think that's in general healthier for a community. But again, I think you can argue with many ways in a different direction, so fair enough.
Is enforcement of the GPL or AGPL necessary for your arguments to hold about it being good for business? Where does enforcement fit in this?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Earlier today, I was arguing that it's never smart to sue your customers or potential partners or potential customers. But of course, if there's zero enforcement ever, then the whole license loses its teeth. I do think that for open source to keep working, or for these licenses to keep working, personally, I think there should be enforcement. But it probably would be best done by organizations like the Linux Foundation or, I don't know, the FSF or other more independent organizations rather than by the companies themselves, because you often end up in a weird conflict of interest, I think. But I do think that, in the end, the difference between the MIT and the GPL disappears if you don't enforce it. And I think that's important. And I think some of the GPL enforcement that has happened has been useful. Some of it, not so much. Depends also on the motivation, of course. But I do think that it's important that there is more than a purely theoretical threat, but of course not so much that the lawyers will balk at using it in the first place. Although I still think that that's a misunderstanding. I mean, I mentioned that I think the GPL is a safer license for a company to deploy simply because it's better understood and better known and more discussed. And I still don't get why company lawyers don't like it. But I think that's more because they're less familiar with it than anything. So I think that's a matter of time before that fixes itself.
So you did address the issue of hyperscale cloud vendors and Amazon more specifically, who's very aggressive in that respect. Mm. And I've actually had this conversation with a few people who are in this business, and well, all of them were basically saying the same thing. Well, there's nothing we can do to stop Amazon from doing that if they actually want to do that. I mean, unless from meddling with licenses in some way. So do you have a suggestion on what you could possibly do? Because, you know, if they actually decide to walk into your turf, what do you do?
Yeah. Well, the thing is, this is of course also true for supermarkets and other companies that are deadly afraid that Amazon comes and kills their business. And it can do there too. And they're not even writing software and there are no licenses at all. yeah, I'm sorry for Mongo and other projects that Amazon came and kind of took their product and kind of killed it in a way for them, or at least made it harder for them to make money. But let's be honest, Amazon would also have been able to just rewrite the bloody thing if the license would have made it hard for them. If they wanted to do this, they can do this. So I don't think the license is terribly relevant in this. If Amazon wants to offer your product as a service to people, they will offer your product as a service to people, even if they have to rewrite it, because they can.
Yeah, there's a difference, though, because they're not just in the scenario you're describing, they would have to basically market it from scratch as something different. While now they're even allowed to squat on your established, you know, logos, on your established community, on everything.
Well, that's limited, right? You still have your trademark, so you can at least forbid them of using your logo, and they can always say that it's compatible with your product, but they could have done that if they rewrote it too. So you're still back to...
It's very complex. I'm just, you know.
I know what you mean. But I think, look, Amazon is doing this all over the place. And I think that what's currently happening in the tech business with a bunch of these really big companies that are, well, having a pretty standard mode of operation where they, I mean, the way Amazon does it is quite brilliant, honestly, right? They let third parties sell things on their products and on their markets. And then when they see that one of these products is doing really well, they just create that product themselves. And of course, then they take over and kill that company or product, which is nasty and legal. And I mean, what can you do? There might be a problem with the fact that we allow companies to get this big, that this is the way they work. But again, our licenses can do a lot, but they cannot fix capitalism or society in general.
Well, you know...
Yeah, we can try.
The counter argument to that is that, well, open source, you know, having an open source license seemed, you know, kind of outlandish before it actually happened. So,
true.
You know, it's not inconceivable that you could actually do something to kind of meddle with that as well. It's I know it's a super complicated topic, just giving you the counter argument.
No, I agree. I mean, it's a bit more nuanced perhaps than that I put it. But yeah, I think it's very much a case by case thing.
Thank you for the talk. I was curious because you talked a lot about the GPL and how it's great for business and how cloud providers are maybe not that much big of a problem. But I was just curious, why did you choose the AGPL then? Because it seems like the AGPL would, you know, I mean, do something similar in a way, you know, enforce distribution if you offer a service and you modify the original code. And that could be something like similar and along the lines of what, you know, MongoDB did in their license, for example.
The main difference between the GPL and the AGPL, and I mean, any lawyer will probably kill me for this, but the way I see it is the main difference is in how they define distribution. So the AGPL is like the GPL in the cloud world, right? I mean, the GPL says if you give a copy of this code to your neighbor, you have to give them the... Well, if you give a copy of this program to your neighbor, you have to give them the same rights, etc. The AGPL says that when you offer it as a service.
Right, yeah, right. I mean, it doesn't forbid you from offering a service, but it still means it's more protective, much more protective than the GPL because...
Well, I would say it protects the freedom of the code in the same way the GPL does, also when you're talking about clouds, and that's why we picked it. It does this level playing field. Because the thing is, of course, you lose this benefit I was talking about a little earlier. Like, essentially, in a cloud world, the GPL becomes like the MIT. And the AGPL fixes that, kind of call it a loophole, if you like. So that's why we picked it. That keeps everybody, again, on equal footing. Still, SUSE cannot come and run this piece of code on their infrastructure and add proprietary extensions. Because the AGPL will block them from this, and they're, again, equal to the student who could not.
So you would say that probably most projects should choose the AGPL who are in a cloud environment. But nowadays that could be like any software, right? I mean,
Well, if they picked the GPL because they liked copyleft, then they should have picked AGPL, because the GPL essentially is toothless in a cloud world. So if you're building cloud software and you want this, these benefits of the GPL, then the license you're looking for is called the AGPL. Otherwise, you could have just picked MIT, which is a fine license in itself, obviously. Again, I don't want to have a whole license fight here, but, you know.
Any... Do you think that the choice of licenses may be influenced by the maturity of the industry you're working in, given that there is a cost of fork, there's a cost of maintaining your own version of upstream, and if you're in a very mature environment where everyone understands that cost, they're more likely to collaborate even on a license where they don't have to?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's certainly the case. Yeah. I don't have much more to say. I think you're right. I think that's absolutely the case. Yeah.
Okay, if there are no more questions, we can roll on to the next talk.
Yeah. Sorry, we're not done yet. Thank you.